What is going on here with CNN political commentator and Republican strategist Anna Navarro and Matt Schlapp, chairman of the American Conservative Union and former political director for President George W. Bush. Good to have you both. We are thankful for your voices on this show as we approach Thanksgiving. And let's show proof of that right now. So, what is this about for LeVar Ball? Is this just about hype? Or do you ascribe any currency to this alternative theory, which is Trump shouldn't be asking for thanks. There's resistance to Trump, and that's what LeVar Ball is about, is harnessing that dissent of the president.
Does it have to be one or the other? Are they mutually exclusive?
I like it clean, but you can mix if you want.
Listen, I think it's both. I think on the one hand, look, what Donald Trump did, if he helped these kids, it's a good thing. I wouldn't want my kid in China. It is a dictatorship. It is a country where the rule of law is not what it is in the United States. I mean, I was thinking of, remember that teenager, that kid that like painted graffiti on a wall in Singapore and got caned?
Yeah.
You want, you know, these are different countries with different sets of laws. What Donald
Trump
stole did
stuff
was good.
You go to jail for that here too.
Exactly. So.
So say thank you.
Say thank you. I don't think it's that hard. I mean, I think there are times where, first of all, Donald Trump should not be asking for thank you, but LeVar Ball should be saying thank you without him saying it. Look, you got two tough-talking showmen who love the hype, who don't back down from a fight. The one doesn't apologize, the other one doesn't say thank you, and they just keep this thing going. And that interview was cuckoo crazy. It was...
Cost me hairline.
Well, hopefully, though, you're getting some, aren't you getting some sports paraphernalia? Aren't you getting some...
Yeah, we'll see. He said he was going to send me some big baller stuff. I was like, I can't wait to give that away to charity. Matt Schlapp, the other side of the ball here is that the president shouldn't have engaged in this. Not only should he not ask for thanks for doing his duty, but why engage with this guy? With all the things that he's not talking about, why go at it with LeVar Ball?
Well, I think one of the reasons he might have realized what a jerk he was. I mean, I can't believe that interview. With my five kids, it's please and thank you, please and thank you. You can say that the president shouldn't ask for a thank you. That's a fair question. But I think it's also a fair answer to say, when someone does something for one of your kids, gets them out of, as Anna said, a dictator's prison, whether it was a hotel or a prison, makes no difference. You say thank you, and this is why so many people across the country are divorcing themselves from their idolization of these professional athletes. The acorn did not fall far from the tree here, but I have to give the son some credit. He acted with class at the press conference, he apologized for his criminal behavior, and he thanked the president. I think he needs to teach his father something.
Well, look, it works both ways. Some of what the president says and some of what his antics have been about has diminished somewhat of the luster on the presidency for a lot of people as well. So let's pivot. I'm good on LeVar Ball. I'm good on this. Until there's the next chapter, I'm good on it. Here's what here's what I want to talk about, all right? Matt Schlapp, make the case for what's going on with the end of the temporary placement plan for Haitians and Nicaraguans and all this. What is this about? Why do this? Because it seems like an attack on one of the fundamental definitions of this country in terms of taking in people in need. Why do this?
Well, I think you have to have boundaries in all these immigration programs. There comes a point where we can't just accept everybody for every reason. I am sympathetic to the cause of these folks, especially the communities in South Florida, but I'm also okay with an administration, with a president who said we can only do things for periods of time. I'm okay with them saying on each one of these populations where we allow people to come to America, especially under a temporary situation, temporary doesn't mean permanent. And I think that's something we all have to understand, which is to get to America is a very special thing. As Anna knows, my father-in-law escaped Cuba. He came here legally, and he wants to be an American. But that's not going to be the case for every person. Sometimes it's going to be a temporary work permit. Sometimes they're going to come here because there's a national or emergency, like a natural disaster. But it's okay for our country to allow people to come here temporarily, but it's okay for us to end those programs.
Well, but it depends. It depends. Anna.
Sure.
I'm telling you, you and Matt, well, maybe you could survive anywhere. Matt and me and I, we couldn't make it in Haiti for 2 weeks. Right now,
I couldn't
make it there. I was there for that earthquake. I've seen the aftermath. I know what's going on there. The idea that we hear from our government that it's okay to go back now is crazy talk. And while Matt is right as a premise, temporary doesn't mean permanent, Why start with these Haitians and the Nicaraguans? I know close to you because of your family, but why start with them? If you want to police legal immigration and reduce the number of people and make it as special as Matt is saying, why start with the most vulnerable?
Because he's got to have something to show, right? This is a guy who made, and first of all, I couldn't hear a word that Matt says, which is fine with me. I think I like him better right now when I can see him and not hear him. But, so I can't respond to what he said. Why? Because immigration was a huge part of Trump's campaign promises. There is no wall. There, you know, they have not deported everybody. So these folks have no voice. They've got no vote. And it's a place to where he can show his base, look, I'm doing something. I frankly think it's not only unconscionable, but it's also going to be incredibly destructive to Miami, to South Florida, where I live. Most of these Haitians, most of these Nicaraguans are there. And here's the problem. It is supposed to be temporary. But for years, Republican and Democrat presidents, Democratic presidents, have let it become not temporary. It's been decades. People have built families. People have built homes. Mm. People have built businesses. People are holding down jobs. People are part of our fiber, particularly in South Florida. Mm. The disruption to our economy, the disruption to families, to U.S. children is going to be ginormous. And the disruption in Latin America. You are said, Haiti is the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. Nicaragua is the second poorest country in the Western Hemisphere.
You're sending people who have tried their best back to the worst. Matt, go ahead. He wants to get in.
Yeah, this is one of the big differences in immigration policy, the idea that someone is a political refugee who we've always given a special status to, as opposed to someone who's an economic refugee. Your premise of your question is you and I would not survive in Haiti, and I agree with you that there's a huge percentage of the population that lives in desperate circumstances. We are very fortunate to be Americans. But it doesn't mean that we need to accept everybody who's in a desperate economic situation. We simply can't sustain doing that. We have to make logical decisions. And I think Anna is right. Temporary usually does become permanent, which is why there's this outcry across America. Having legal status in America, you should have to go through the legal process. And becoming an American, you shouldn't get to do it just because you came here in a temporary status.
Now, what is important, though, is that there is something, I think, like 18 months before this goes into effect. Look, we've got 800,000 kids right now whose lives are limbo because of the DREAM Act, of DACA. We've got
Because of Barack Obama.
The Nicaraguans. We've got 55,000 Haitians. So Congress needs to act. If something's going to get done, Congress has 18 months, it's got even less on the DACA side, to act, and they need to act quickly. They need to have a comprehensive, fair immigration policy that has border security and also takes care of these people who are Americans in every way but one. Mm.
All right, thank you very much. Look, if nothing else, they're going to have a huge practical problem. If they want to get these people out of the country and their kids are here, how are they going to do it? It's a first line that sounds strong, may play to jingoism as well, but how are you going to do it? It's going to be tough. Anna.